She was very tall, her glance most fierce, her voice harsh. A great mass of the reddest hair fell down to her hips. Around her neck, a large golden necklace. And she always wore a tunic of many colors over which she fastened a thick cloak with a brooch. Her appearance was terrifying.
Boudica has her own place in British folk history. The warrior queen who fought her terrible but unavailing struggle against the might of Rome. A story so dramatic that its strange Hollywood never seized on it. Now the virago on the scythed chariot is so ingrained in our minds that cartoonists could portray Mrs. Thatcher as Boudica after her election victory, knowing that we would all immediately get the point. In fact, Boudica only became known to the British public in the reign of Elizabeth I, and it was under that other great queen, Victoria, that she really became enshrined in the popular imagination. And Prince Albert himself was the patron of this colossal group, conceived at the height of the British Empire. It encapsulates all the myths. The queen's name was not Boadicea, which is a Renaissance spelling mistake. It was Boudica, meaning Victoria. The chariots were not armored carts. They were light, flexible, fast wicker vehicles, which may even have had blades on their wheels. And whatever Boudica herself looked like, she didn't look like Isadora Duncan as played by Vanessa Redgrave. But there she is. That's an image we're unlikely to ever lose. What archaeologists are now discovering is that her story is far more complex, strange, and exciting than even Prince Albert could have guessed. It is the story of the bitterest war ever fought in Britain, a desperate colonial struggle against imperialism, and a story which archaeology has confirmed in sensational detail. It lasted only a few months in AD 61, but it involved the violent destruction of the chief cities of southern England, the slaughter of thousands of their inhabitants, and atrocities beside which those in Cambodia or the Vietnam War pale. And it all happened through the will of one woman. Boudica came from Norfolk. Her people, the Iceni, are still a mystery to us. Above the ground, they've left us few traces, like these enigmatic earthworks near Warham. They were one of several British tribes who submitted to the Roman invaders, but they maintained a privileged status akin to the client states in India under the British Raj. Up to the revolt, the Iceni were still allowed to mint their own coins, although they also had to take huge loans to Romanize, the Roman equivalents of aid and Coca-Cola monopolies. Finds of these Iceni coins and other wealth have suggested to historians a threefold division of the tribe, in the north near Warham, in the southwest around the Brecklands and Sayam, and further east near the later town which bore the name of the Iceni and whose ruins still stand at Caister by Norwich. But where did it all start? Where was Boudica's royal center? Archaeologist Tony Gregory thinks it still lies hidden somewhere near the later town.
It's very likely that there was a major Iceni center of some sort in this area. Here we've got these bluffs running down, running more or less east-west this way with valleys in between them, going down to the Roman town in that direction. And it's almost a perfect spot for settlement of any period. We really don't even know what we're looking for if we're looking for Boudica's palace.
What do we know about the Iceni or the Iceni? What kind of people were they?
Well, very little. They're certainly a Celtic people. They, we assume, spoke a Celtic language like Welsh or Scots Celtic. They also possessed a very, very strong tradition of producing very fine, fancy metalwork. Mm. And the material found at Snettisham, the material from the hoard at St. Tony, they all build up to give this picture of a very strong, very rich society. And yet, when we look at what few sites of the period we've got for occupation sites, they're really nothing compared with the wealth of the metalwork. You get a picture there of simple farmers, and yet all this wealth is being poured into the metalwork. It's a very peculiar situation.
While the professionals remain in a dilemma over the Iceni, an amateur, Robin Brown, has turned up what looks to be the most significant Iceni centre yet found. It is literally in his back garden.
Robin, what evidence have you found here for a native settlement?
Well, principally, there's been a spread of Iron Age coins around the site, and quite a widespread one, covering most of the centre of this area. We found a small quantity of the Iron Age coin flan moulds, you know. And this, to me, implies that we've got an important site, one where there was a mint.
What do they look like?
Well, I've got one here. They're nothing very exciting to look at. Portions of poorly baked clay, which used to be, of course, much bigger, with these little circular holes in the centre into which the silver was poured. And then when they were ready to strike the coins, they would turn them the other way up and the little blobs of silver would fall out, and then they'd be struck with the obverse and the reverse dies. And I can't see that this sort of thing would be at any other site than an important pre-Roman site where they were making their own coins. This is the sort of little Iceni coin that we find around here. Silver with the Iceni horse on one side and some variation of pattern on the other. This is a late Iron Age brooch.
This is the sort of thing that Boudica herself might have pinned her cloak with.
It's possible. It's been badly bent in the years that it's been in the soil, and broken too. But it's in quite good condition considering its age.
There aren't many sites of this kind in Norfolk, are there?
Not many have been found, no.
So it's not impossible that this was Boudica's centre.
That's all. I'd like to think that, yes.
Considering the size and ferocity of the revolt, its background then is still a blank, and the state of Iceni civilization on the eve of the catastrophe remains a mystery to us. Jesus College, Oxford. From this point in the story of the revolt, we're no longer dependent on archaeological evidence alone. We can turn to one of the greatest historians, Cornelius Tacitus.
It would be quite impossible to write the story of the revolt without Tacitus. Tacitus is the foundation on which all historians and archaeologists must work. And that is to say that we're looking at the motives of Boudica and her supporters through the eyes of a highly educated upper-class Roman, albeit one with a wide and sympathetic knowledge of Celtic and Germanic tribes. What gives Tacitus's account its great value for us is first his status as a first-rate historian, a man dedicated to writing history without anger or bias, as he put it. But also, and perhaps more interestingly, his father-in-law, Julius Agricola, later famous as governor in Britain, was present in this campaign as a junior officer. And so although Tacitus was just a boy at the time, it's not unreasonable to think that in later years he would be able to talk to his father-in-law about these events. And indeed, there are passages in Tacitus's account which sound very much like first-hand reporting. That's not to say that we can be sure that we've got what Tacitus wrote in every instance. Although he was very famous in his lifetime, his works were lost in the Dark Ages, and our account of Boudica is dependent on one manuscript which survives in Florence, one manuscript alone. And here in Jesus College, Oxford, is a manuscript dependent on that original. It was written around 1458, copied from a manuscript now in Parma, and it's part of the process by which classical culture was transmitted to England during the Renaissance. And here we find Boudica in a glorious misspelling, Buina. She also appears as Boudicea. In fact, it's in the Florentine manuscript that we find the better spelling of Boudica. But with this kind of mistake, it's not surprising she appeared on the Elizabethan stage as Bonduca. In general, Tacitus simplifies the story a great deal. We know that the political maneuvering between the tribes who were in favor of the Romans being there and those who were anti was more complicated than he tells us. Basically, he sees it in terms of personalities. Prasutagus, the rich and long-ruling king of the Iceni, husband of Boudica, dies, and the Romans seize this opportunity to change the arrangement they have with the Iceni and reduce them to normal provincial status. Outrages were committed against Boudica and her family and the nobles, and they rose in revolt. They were joined by the Trinovantes, whose grievances against the Romans centered on the loss of their lands, which were given to settlers and retired veterans around Colchester. What Tacitus doesn't tell us, and what we may never find out, is whether the revolt was more premeditated than that. But what Tacitus does tell us is that the main aim of the rebels was to destroy Colchester, the blatant symbol of alien rule. Colchester was the gleaming capital of the new province across the sea. Dominating the town, the Temple of Claudius, constructed on a massive plinth on which the Norman castle now stands. This was the largest classical temple in Britain. To the Romans, a monument to their conquest. To the Britons, who paid for its upkeep, the hated symbol of the new order. Here, in the tribal capital of the Trinovantes, the Roman veterans had taken land, married local girls, put their savings into businesses. Here they went to the theatre and the games, or to a grand new forum which underlay the present town hall in High Street.
High Street was the main shopping centre of the Roman town, and thanks to the excavations here, we know a certain amount about life in the colony before Boudica struck. We know that up on the right, there was a seed warehouse where Roman veterans who'd taken up farming could buy their supplies. There was a pottery shop further up, with stocked with hundreds of bowls of Samian. That was the everyday household ware, along with glass and jars and lamps. There was a local lamp industry here. But here by the Red Lion was the most interesting sight. Quite close to where we're standing, a shop was uncovered recently, stocked with fine decorated bowls and also large numbers of herbs and spices, dill, anise, opium poppy, coriander for flavoring foods, and stone pine, which imported from Italy, which Italians used to allow to dry in the sun and then pick out the seeds to eat. And even figs, fresh figs, not dried figs, so they probably weren't imported. They were actually grown near Colchester. So there we've got what I suppose is a high-class delicatessen for upper-class retired Romans. And here up Lion Walk was another fascinating insight into life here before Boudica. Near here, in 1974, the remains of a fruit shop were discovered, and in the debris, a pile of dates. They were probably imported in amphorae or storage jars from the Mediterranean, like other products we know of at this time, like fish paste, wine, and so on. Like them, the dates show that the Roman colonists and their British wives could buy anything that any self-respecting Italian would wish. The colonial life here, it seems, was a good life.
In a villa in this field, 40 miles from Colchester, a Roman couple lived the good life too. They were among the first to be murdered. Roland Parker found their villa and pieced together the story of its destruction.
The first thing we noticed about it, although the significance didn't dawn on us immediately, was the fact that it had been completely hidden. The whole site where we are now had been completely covered with a 1-inch thick layer of very fine gravel, which was a bit off-putting. Nevertheless, we found a few clues which were encouraging, bits of Samian pottery and so on, and then we made the first, I suppose really the first exciting discovery, namely that the east end of the villa at least had been destroyed by fire. The ring of charcoal, burnt things, nails and so on, told us that much, and in the process discovered the rubbish pit. The very thing which we'd been hoping and praying for all this time, we discovered by pure accident. It wasn't more than 10 minutes' work to demonstrate that it was the rubbish pit and that it was packed full of interesting things. I can't enumerate them all, obviously, but this is what they included. The remains of a burnt and broken oak door, complete with hinges. And then we found these. Lock bolts, two, both broken. Broken by violence, indicating that that door was opened that time, not with a key, but with a tree trunk or something similar. That was the first indication we had that there was violence of another kind other than fire involved in the destruction of the villa. But finally, the climax came 9 o'clock on the morning of September the 29th, 1972. I can't forget it, because in the third of the cesspits, there was nothing but black filth. My attention was distracted for a moment, and there, sitting in the black slime confronting me, was this. Now, what it is a seal stone originally set in a massive gold ring worn on the finger. It had then been prized from its gold setting by a sharp instrument on the original. This is not the original, by the way. The original I gave to the Fitzwilliam Museum. It's there now. On the original, you can in fact see traces where it was prized from its setting. It put the seal on the story which had been unfolding gradually over 5 years. Here was the culmination of the evidence of violence, theft, fear, and all the rest of it. I feel convinced that this crime was the work of the revolting Ikeni.
Rumor spread like wildfire. In Colchester, Tacitus says people were seized with foreboding of some terrible disaster. Shapes like human corpses were left by the ebb tide. Delirious women screamed that destruction was at hand. Dreadful moans were heard in the Senate House. The theatre echoed with shrieks. A blood-red colour was seen in the sea, and at the estuary a phantom settlement appeared in ruins. These omens, Tacitus says, were interpreted hopefully by the Britons and with terror by the Romans. Came swiftly. Boudica surrounded Colchester and put it to the torch. Most of the buildings were of wood and the town was swept by a firestorm. In the pottery shop in High Street, stocks were smashed to pieces before it was fired, leaving these fragments of red samian burned black. Glass shop near the forum, the heat was so intense that molten glass poured onto the floor and cooled in these twisted shapes. A Roman bandsman's gear was stamped on and broken before his house was burned to the ground. This head of an equestrian statue of the Emperor Claudius was hacked off and thrown into a river. And of those who died in the fire, these few pathetic remains have been found. Those who escaped, and the Romans had evacuated none of the women and children, fled to the one area that had withstood the fire and where they might hope to hold out against Boudica's hordes, the precinct of the temple.
And here we are inside the vaults of the temple of Claudius. These vaults run the full length
of the temple platform. And if you look through here, this 10-foot-thick central supporting wall, you can see the other vault running parallel to it, exposing the full width of the podium. The temple was about 80 feet wide and well over 100 feet long. These were full of sand. In fact, they still are. These arches go down about twice as deep as the level we're standing. This is modern concrete, of course, to support the weight of thousands of tons of Norman castle above us. The temple stood in the middle of a precinct with a wall about 500 feet by 400 feet, the kind of area that the defenders could have held out with a few hundred Roman soldiers and their families. Whether they did or not, we don't know. But we do know what happened in the final catastrophe. Eventually, the last defenders of Colchester were forced to take refuge within the thick walls of the temple itself, literally barricaded in above our heads. They may have hoped that reinforcements would come and save them, but no reinforcements came. They've held out for 2 days, and then the Achaeni piled brushwood and logs against the temple, probably set fire to the roof. They will have battered the doors down with great log battering rams, and they brutally slaughtered everyone inside. Nobody survived. In a final outrage, the rebels even desecrated the Roman cemetery, mutilating statues and breaking tombstones. They can still be seen in Colchester Museum. Longinus, a junior cavalry officer from the Balkans, shown proudly riding over the conquered race. One of Boudica's rebels has smashed away his face, but left the Briton cowering below him intact. The stone was thrown over and shattered. The revolt now gained a momentum of its own. With their vast supply of fine horses, the Achaeni aristocracy possessed great speed and mobility. They and their allies, the Trinovantes, poured south, destroying other towns and settlements, Chelmsford, St. Albans. Everywhere an orgy of killing and destruction. But they were not a leaderless mob. The commander of the nearest Roman legion, the 9th, moved immediately to intercept the rebels, but he underestimated Boudica. The Roman legionaries were ambushed and wiped out. Only the cavalry escaped. Suddenly, the whole Roman presence in Britain was at stake. The governor, Suetonius Paulinus, was with the main army far away in Wales. And with the 9th gone, Boudica's next prey lay wide open. London is a Roman creation. It was set up to exploit the wealth of the new province, and the exploiters had crowded in. Its population was growing apace. Brian Hobley, director of archaeology for the city.
It was a thriving merchant town. Tacitus, in fact, records that the city at this time was thriving with merchants and traders, and it must have been reckoned in thousands, tens of thousands.
What do you think the character of the town was like?
Character? If one likens it to an American boom town in the middle of the 19th century, a Wild West frontier town, I think this captures the atmosphere of it all. It started in 50 as a direct result to try and open up the province as an economic viable member of the empire. And we see, in fact, the laying out of streets and buildings and insula. And at the time of the Boudican attack, one would be seeing buildings going up and great amount of activity on the port side, on the Thames side, and the whole atmosphere of growth and development.
So there would have been a financial aspect to the city as well, would there?
Absolutely. I mean, it's not beyond the bounds of possibility that the procurator, the emperor's own personal finance officer for the province, had established his headquarters here, and not at Colchester, where the governor would have his establishment at this time.
What do you think the impact of the news of the rebellion had on the people here?
Terror and horror. We know, in fact, that there were no defences. We know also that there wasn't a garrison here. There's no evidence, archaeologically speaking, of a fort. So therefore, it was an open city as far as the inhabitants were concerned, and there was no means by which the Boudican horde could be stopped.
Meanwhile, Governor Suetonius Paulinus was riding hell for leather day and night to London to see whether the huge Roman investment could be saved.
Suetonius came into London along Watling Street, which is now the Edgware Road, which ends here at Marble Arch, where we're now standing. And he will have gone into the city itself, down the Roman Road, which lies under Oxford Street there. All this was open country then. The ribbon development of the new boom town only started at about Newgate. When he got into the civic centre, and presumably took a stiff wine in the procurator's office, his intelligence reports will have soon told him how serious the situation was. Colchester wiped out, the 9th Legion disabled, and the Iceni and Trinovantes joined by other disaffected tribes. And for the first time, he will have learned something of the size of Boudica's army. London, of course, had no walls, and what Suetonius heard convinced him not to defend it. He decided, in Tacitus's words, to sacrifice the city to save the province, and unmoved by prayers and tears, gave the signal to depart. Well, that must have set in panic in the city, and we can imagine streams of refugees with their belongings heading towards the pro-Roman tribes in the south. Those who were left, those who would not or could not go, were left to anxiously wait on what proved to be the last dawn of the first London.
The town was completely destroyed. The evidence is everywhere. Wherever you dig into the foundations of London, you come across a red and black layer of burned ash and soot. These stills were taken at a site near St. Paul's before it was handed over to the developers in 1979. Other details have been uncovered. Food jars thrown into rubbish pits. A hoard of money whose owner never came back to claim it. The familiar burned Samian. And whereas at Colchester the human remains are slight, here the archaeologist has found signs which back Tacitus up in his statement that Boudica took no prisoners. They could not wait to cut throats, hang, burn, and crucify, he says. And Roman and provincial deaths were 70,000.
The financial heart of the Roman town, under Cornhill, the Royal Exchange here, and the Bank of England, was laid to ashes. And it's here that we get our first hard evidence of the kind of atrocities that were committed by both sides during this war. Tacitus passes over the detail, but the later writer, Dio Cassius, tells us that the Britons hung up the Roman women that they captured, cut off their breasts and sewed them to their mouths and impaled them on sharpened stakes. One's first reaction to that story is that whoever made it up got it from some lurid Roman anthropology book. It's got all the trappings of modern atrocity propaganda, Huns bayoneting babies, Vietnamese Russian roulette, and so on. But it may be, as Tacitus implies, that these atrocities were committed in fulfillment of some religious ritual demanded by the Druids, which brings us to these. A large number of these skulls have been found in the Roman silt of the Walbrook stream to the west of the bank. There are about 25 of them in the London Museum alone, and they're always found with no other skeletal remains. Now, we know that these Celtic rituals included the use of the severed heads of the vanquished, and it does seem that these skulls are the heads of Londoners who suffered at the hands of Boudica's vengeful army of liberation.
It's exactly 3:30. Radio 1. We're James.
Firemen in Belfast are still battling to control a city centre blaze.
Drive along the A5 and you're travelling on Suetonius's line of retreat. By now, both sides were under pressure. Suetonius to get back to his bases, gather in his reinforcements, and Boudica to follow him and to swiftly strike the decisive blow. Any delay on her part, and the Roman governor of Gaul could land a fresh fleet at the Roman supply base in Kent and attack her from the rear. And what personal power it must have taken on her part to push her army into following Suetonius, we can only guess. Look at the A5, the old Roman Watling Street, which bisects the M1 and the M6. Straight as a die, it's been an artery for travel in this country for 2,000 years. Look for a defensive position against an attack from the south. Nowhere appears in the flat country around Rugby until you get past Nuneaton. And then this line of bluffs starts to rise on your left, gradually getting nearer to the road. Where the bluffs and the river anchors, which flows underneath them, and the road meet, you have it, a defensive position. The place is called Mansetta.
The Romans later called the site Manduesedum, the place of chariots. Tacitus gives a description of the final battlefield. Suetonius was in a defile with woods behind him and open country in front. But Tacitus does not say where this was, and there have been many fruitless attempts to find it. It was only after journeying up and down Watling Street, looking for a site that fitted, that Graham Webster put forward Mansetta. And recently, archaeological evidence has come up to suggest he's right.
Well, the interesting thing about this place is the great quartzite ridge, which stretches away behind us, rising up quite suddenly from the plain because of a geological fault. So you get a dramatic change from a flat open plain to a steep slope full of these defiles which Tacitus mentions, which are over at the back of us. And then, by chance, Adrian Oswald, from the then at the City of Birmingham Museum, dug a trench across an earthwork which lies to the south of here, where there was a definite change of level above the river Anchor. And he thought that this could possibly have been a Roman defences. But it proved that it wasn't, but underneath it were the true military defences of this period. And so we got the first indication of the presence of a fort here. Keith Scott, who is a local archaeologist, was able to look at some holes people had dug around here for various purposes and produced an amazing assortment of material and timber buildings of a military type.
So what kind of force are we talking about?
Well, it looks as if the area is something of the order of between 20 and 30 acres, in which case it would have been a legionary establishment. And this fits with the other finds he made. Now, this armour, you can see the curve of it, you see, is part of the shoulder piece up here of a typical lorica segmentata of a legionary. And there you've got one of the hinges for the straps, and this is a little decorated stud which you go on the top. And the other piece we've got here is one of the pieces that go on the body. And this, of course, is typical legionary armour. So that and the pottery make it almost certain that there would have been, the 14th Legion would have been here.
The 14th was the backbone of the Roman army in the final battle. So Suetonius was returning to a base he already knew. And if Graham Webster is right, it was here along the river that the Romans lined up. Legionaries in the centre, cavalry on the wings. The British cavalry and infantry seethed over the plain in front, keeping up a terrific noise to frighten the Romans, so confident of victory that they stationed their wives and families in carts around the edge of the field to watch the slaughter. The two leaders now gave final speeches to their troops. It's unlikely Tacitus knew what Boudica had said, but one line rings true. It is a taunt to the men. Win the battle or perish. That is what I, a woman, will do. You men can live on in slavery if that's what you want. This is what Suetonius said as the Romans faced up. Ignore the racket made by these savages. There are more women than men in their ranks. They're not soldiers. They're not even properly equipped. We've beaten them before, and when they see our weapons and our spirit, they'll crack. Stick together, throw the javelins, push forward, knock them down with your shields, and finish them off with your swords. Forget about booty. Just win, and you'll have the lot. Suetonius let the Britons crowd up on the Roman line before he gave the order. A volley of several thousand javelins was thrown into them at about 40 yards, followed by a second. Then the Romans attacked in tight array. There is nothing romantic about ancient battles, and in this one the Britons had no chance despite their numbers. In fact, their numbers made it worse. They were crushed onto each other so they couldn't use their long swords. The Roman cavalry worked round their flanks, and soon the packed rear ranks ran. In such battles, more are killed in the flight than in the fighting, and the Romans consciously took revenge. Driven against their carts, the Britons were slaughtered even when they tried to surrender. Men, women, children, even pack animals. Tacitus says 80,000 were killed. The Romans lost 400 dead and more wounded. His information was that Boudica took poison. Where she was buried, we don't know. The whole revolt lasted a few months, in which time it spread from Norfolk to Somerset. For a moment, the future of the Roman province of Britain hung on a thread, but the moment had passed. Now the Roman military establishment would make sure it never happened again. Ten miles from the battlefield, a great supply base was set up at a place called the Lunt, near Coventry, as the first stage in the Roman army's campaign of revenge. Brian Hobley supervised its excavation and reconstruction.
Brian, what do you think the aftermath of the battle was like?
Well, Tacitus tells us that the army were kept in the field right through the winter. We also know, in fact, that some 7,000 reinforcements were brought in from Germany.
How did the Romans behave towards the rebels once they'd won?
Again, Tacitus clearly tells us that Suetonius Paulinus was brutal in the extreme. He was a very hard professional soldier who not only believed that the battle was won on the battlefield, but one had to take the battle right to the heartland of the tribal people.
So what did the Romans do in practical terms?
They moved back into Iceni and Trinovanti territory. A whole system of forts were erected, and in fact the Lunt fort that we're in now can be seen as a main factor in that system of forts. It's almost certainly a store base and a major campaign center.
Brian, how did you know what this was when you found a circular mark in the ground?
We had no other parallels to go on at all. In fact, this is a unique feature within any Roman fort within the whole of the Roman Empire. We just had to look at its circular shape, the fact it was 100 feet in diameter, and had a very interesting funneled, double-gated entrance, which suggested to us, in fact, it was some sort of compound, corral, or arena for livestock.
So you're imagining the Romans after the battle bringing in hundreds of Iceni horses here?
Indeed, yes. This would be a large area outside the fort gates. There would be hundreds of horses awaiting breaking in and then shipment off to the frontier.
How would you assess the significance of the Lunt then in the period after the revolt?
We see, in fact, that the Lunt, with many other forts in the southeast, representing the Romans' nervousness about their frontier situation. They were not going to go into a frontier expansive situation while this question of unsettled people was with them.
As the army moved into Norfolk, a chain of forts was constructed across Iceni territory, including ones at Saem Tony, at Warham, and probably at Caister. After the fire and sword came a second stage. The Iceni would be Romanized through and through, to enjoy the full benefits of Roman civilization.
A few years after the revolt, the Iceni were moved down from their old tribal center and resettled in a new town planned on the Roman model here at Caister by Norwich. It was called Venta Icenorum, the market town of the Iceni. It was never a great success. It remained half empty for years, its plots not taken up, even though the Romans later dignified it with a forum, walls, and civic baths. At the fall of the Roman Empire, it was deserted and became a quarry for building stone, and its great central area was eventually turned over to farming. But its walls still stand 20 feet high and 12 feet thick here under these banks, and the pattern of its streets was still visible from the air when this area was laid out to summer crop. As for the Icani themselves, a whole generation must have been wiped out by the war and by the devastation, famine, and slavery that followed it, and the Romans will have ruthlessly purged the royal and noble families. The ordinary people, of course, carried on living here, and at the end of the Roman period, they're lost to history. But it may be that the British-speaking fen dwellers, the itinerant horse dealers and thieves who continue to live on the fringe of Norfolk society for centuries afterwards, were the last of the true Icani. Of Boudica herself, though, no trace has ever been found, except in the pages of the historians of her bitterest enemies.